sharing that with y'all too. Okay. On lesson four, on page 33, how was Jesus able? I'm going to read a portion of the information where we drew this from. How was Jesus able to perform all of his mighty works as a man after he laid down his Godhead powers? Okay, let's turn over to the answer. In lesson four, yeah, page 31, okay. All right, page 31. Let's look at number one through whatever. We'll start with number one. Jesus performed all of the works that he was sent to do as a man, anointed by God, and not as a man as he were in his pre-existent state. He never took credit for one miracle or work he performed, nor for one sermon he taught or preached. He attributed all the mighty deeds that were done through him to his Father and to the Holy Spirit. The Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the work, is what Jesus himself said in John 14:10. All the works that he did in his Father's name were done through the power of the Holy Spirit. Okay. All right. So you can see the scriptures above. Number one, you can see Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. So that showed that he did all the works that he did, not as God. You know, the God part of him, the deity, was the part that he manifested in his pre-existent state. But in his humanity state, he did not operate as deity. He operated as a man, anointed by the Holy Ghost. And Acts 10:38 is your best verification for that. That's your best verification. Amen. Now, Luke 4:18 also is a good one. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, the opening of the eyes of the blind, so forth and so on. So those two scriptures are scriptures that's directly related to Jesus operating and performing all of the works that he did as a man anointed by God. So as a man anointed by God is the same way we, James Hill, Travis Stewart, a man anointed by God. Brother Al Jackson, a man anointed by God. So he had to bring it down to the level where he wouldn't be doing all these works in the power of his deity, but in the power of the Holy Spirit as a man anointed. Amen. That's the only way Jesus could be our example. That's the only way that he could tell us the works that he did, we are to do all also. That's the only reason why we are focusing on this time and time and time again. Because all of us, most of us, have a tendency to feel that Jesus operated not as a man anointed by the Holy Spirit, but as a man, as deity, as the Son of God, using all of his pre-existence with power and anointed. That's the way many times we lose out on, our faith doesn't kick in correctly, because we feel that Jesus was altogether in a different category. But these things we're pointing out tonight are trying to get over to us that if Jesus operated as a man anointed by God, then we can operate and do the same works that he did as a what? Man or woman. Amen. Anointed by what? The Holy Spirit. Amen. I mean, we just can't go over this enough, because We have fixed in our minds that I can't do this, I can't do that. And many times we just don't approach people, we just don't use our ministries and the ability that God has given us because we feel that we're not capable of measuring up to the works that Jesus did. All right, number two, we're still on page 31. He never took credit. Did we read that? Did we read number two? Y'all can't remember.
No, you read
really
number two.
Okay. How many here have you read number two? All right. I read number two, y'all. You never took credit for one miracle or work he performed, nor for one sermon he taught or preached. He attributed all the mighty deeds that were done through him to his Father and to the Holy Spirit. Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the work. That's what Jesus consists of. And that's what we can say. Everybody can just say that individually. Amen. Praise God. Every time I hear you say that, y'all remind me, every time you say that and I hear you, amen, remind me that I owe you something. Amen. I might be willing to pay up to $5 every time I hear it because I probably won't hear nobody say it. The Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the work. Now, these are things people back away from because they feel like, amen, although the Father's in us, but what, he's not going to do it through me. He did it through Jesus, but he ain't going to do it through me. Amen. That's the reason why we need to understand who we are in Christ. That's what we're going to be teaching, I guess, a little bit of that after we get off of holiness. All right. Everybody like me now?
Mm-hmm.
All right. We're on the same page. All right. Now, number three, Jesus was dependent. Jesus was just as dependent on the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost as we are in our life today. Many see Jesus' ministry, and works in a unique category. We're going to discuss this. Many see Jesus' ministry and works in a unique category, unattainable by us today, and not as a man like us. We sometimes view his ability to do what he did in his earthly ministry as the same ability he exercised in his pre-existent state. Before he emptied himself of his omnipotence, all right, omniscience, I want y'all to help me to break these words down. Omnipresence and other divine powers. All right. Now, these are the powers that he exercised in his pre-existent state as God or as deity. He was omnipotent. Okay, what does that mean, everybody? Omnipotent. All right. All what?
Powerful.
All right. Omniscience means what? All knowing, all wisdom, all right? Omnipresence. All right, and other divine powers. Can anybody give us an illustration of how these pre-existent qualities were not manifested in Jesus' earthly ministry? Can anybody give us some illustrations of how these pre-existent powers were not manifested in Jesus' ministry? Give us some illustration. All right, could Jesus be everywhere at the same time in his earthly ministry?
No. Because he was here.
All right, because he was what?
Here on earth.
All right, he was here on earth, so he couldn't be what? Everywhere at the what? Same time, all right? All right, what about his omniscience? Was he all wisdom, all knowing? Did he know everything? All right. What do you say, Sister Perry?
He knew what the Father told him. He told us that in John, he said that I do what I hear my Father say.
Yeah, I do what my Father say. In other words, I do nothing of my what? Self. In other words, I'm not exercising my what? My deity rights. In terms of knowing everything from the beginning to the end, I have to seek God so I know what's going to happen tomorrow, what to do today. Amen. He did nothing of himself. That means nothing of his own wisdom or his own innate abilities. Everything that he did, I know what I'm saying is just going right over our heads. I hope it's not. It's not falling on deaf ears, is it? Because if we don't get this, we'll never feel comfortable operating in our power and authority, because we feel that Jesus had somewhat unfair advantages over us. And he's telling us the works that... Okay. He said, the works that I do, ye shall what? Do also, and what? Greater works. All right, so y'all believe that we can do greater works than Jesus today? All right, what kind of works would those be if you can do greater works than Jesus? What kind of works would those be? Okay, now that is a possibility. Okay, somebody give me another slant on that. What else could it refer to? Okay, Sister Denise? Okay, Sister Denise, I'm going to have to go back here. I can't hear. We need another mic. You're pretty active. You talk. You always bring up the scriptures that I don't know. You'll be somewhere close. All right. Okay. So Jesus said we should do greater works than the works that he did. So that could relate to maybe more. It's kind of hard, difficult for us to conceive of us doing more works in volume than Jesus. But he was here only three years. Billy Graham perhaps maybe preached to more people than Jesus, maybe, I don't know. Possibly.
Average lifespan.
Okay. Now, the greater works could be a greater volume of people, more people exposure, bigger congregations, bigger crowds, more nations are now in existence. I heard Brother Hagin. The way that he explains it is that before Jesus actually ascended and took his blood and sealed our redemption with his blood, the new covenant did not come into existence until Jesus had finalized his redemptive work. And that was after he ascended and sent back the Holy Spirit. That's when the apostles start preaching our remission of sins and salvation through faith. That came through the apostle Paul. Brother Hagin explains that as greater works refer to we're able to get people saved today and filled with the Holy Spirit, whereas Jesus did not focus on getting people saved because he operated under the old covenant. Jesus was operated on the old covenant. And it wasn't possible to be saved until Jesus had finished the redemptive work. Everybody go along with that? So the greater works would be works of that magnitude in which a person can be born again because they were born again under the new covenant. Amen. So that is considered as a greater work than the works that he did. Even miracles, signs, and wonders, and all the supernatural things Jesus did, amen, the salvation of a soul is greater. And Jesus didn't get anybody filled with the Holy Ghost either. All right, now look at me straight. It wasn't that he didn't have the power to do it, but what? That didn't operate. The old covenant did not include people getting saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. Because a person could not be filled with the Holy Spirit and God could not come in and dwell within a person and make his abode 24/7 until Jesus had what? Finished his redemptive work and sent back the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost to indwell men. Amen. So that's when people began to get saved, when Peter, them, and the disciples began to preach what? remission of sin and faith in the Lord Jesus. Amen. So the greater works we can do. Tell somebody near you, did you know you can do greater works than Jesus? I know some of y'all going to still say, Jesus was God. Sister Sharon, they're going to pull that over here every time. Jesus is God. I ain't God. Amen. Praise the Lord. That's the reason why we need to get, we need to pray that the eyes of our understanding might be what? All right, might be enlightened. Everybody get it? All right. Oh, praise the Lord. All right. I'm going to ask somebody the same question. What are the greater works? Somebody's not going to be listening. All right. Let's move on, saints. All right. So none of those are big qualities, are omnipotence and omniscience and omnipresence and other divine powers. They did not operate in Jesus' life. He did not use those, although he exercised these privileges in his deity. In other words, before he came down as a man, he was just a what? Part of what the triune being, I mean the part of the Godhead. So God the Father, Christ, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, all of those are intangible. They're not, they're spiritual beings, and they are not what, physical beings as we know them today. All right, let's look at number four. Only a man, watch this, who never sinned, and being a spotless sacrifice, he is on a class by himself. Only as a man who never sinned and being, now that's the only way that Jesus differs from us today. Only as a man who never sinned. And all of us what have sinned and come, that's the way he's different from us. But in terms of God's power operating in you, that doesn't affect your ability to do the works that you did. Everybody understand that? Amen. How many feel that you're saved, you're filled with the Holy Spirit, and when you get your mind renewed, how many, amen, when you get your mind renewed, that means your spirit man is going to exert authority over your what? Over your what? Over your physical being, right? All right, everybody say amen. That's what mind renewing means, that your body is subservient to what? Your human spirit, you recreated human spirit. Your body is subservient. In other words, you don't obey the dictates of your flesh. Because when you walk by the Spirit, you won't obey the what? Amen. The lust of your flesh. If you walk in the Spirit, everybody say walk in the Spirit.
Walk in the Spirit.
Say it again.
Walk in the Spirit.
Yes. Bible says if you walk in the Spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So how many believe you can make your spirit the dominant person in your life? All right, how many believe that? Amen. Y'all act like you believe it. How many believe that you can make your spirit the dominant man?
Amen.
All right, now you can't do it just by twiddling your thumbs. I'm doing wishful thinking. I wish it came that easy. I wouldn't have to work so hard at it. Well, I'm not working. I'm just resting. But you do have to do something. Well, somebody said believing is the only thing you can do without doing anything. All right. All right, so let's see how we can build the inner man, the spirit man, to the point where he will dominate your outer man. Because when the outer man comes under the power of your human spirit, it will also affect your mind, or your soulish life, your mind. Because they say that the body has the greatest influence on your life than even any other part of your body. Because if you're going to be drawn in sin, usually it's going to start from some craving you have in your body that responds to something that the devil brings to your mind.
Yes.
Everybody get it?
Amen.
Amen. We know that Satan is very active in the realm of the mind, right? Very active. But he doesn't have power to make you do one thing or the other, right or wrong, just by bringing things to your what? Mind. He can't make you submit to anything that he brings to your mind. That's up to you. And that depends a whole lot on what's going on in your body. If it entices your body, if it turns your body on, if your body is responding to it, then more than likely you will what? You will submit to those enticements or those temptations that the enemy brings to your mind. But he doesn't have a power in the mental realm to make you do anything that he suggests. Ain't that good to know?
Amen.
So if you walk in the Spirit, everybody say, walk in the Spirit.
Walk in the Spirit.
You won't fulfill what else?
The lust of
your what? Flesh. All right, the Bible says put on. Everybody said put on. All right, put on the Lord Jesus. What does that mean? Put on the Lord Jesus and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust thereof. So that's the way you overcome your flesh, by putting on the Lord Jesus, yielding your members as instruments of righteousness unto sin, unto righteousness. Yielding your members as instruments of righteousness. Amen. And everybody said, my members got to be used for the glory of God. And not for what? Not for serving what? Sin. Or fulfilling your what? Your lust. Amen. Praise God. Y'all know what lust is? Y'all know what lust is? Somebody just tell me what lust is.
Anything that makes you do the wrong thing.
All right. Anything that makes you do what? The wrong thing. It's something innate in us that will respond to the wrong thing. I mean, that's the lustful part of us. Respond to the wrong thing quicker than we respond to the what? Until your mind is renewed. When your mind is renewed, you're programmed to respond. As long as the devil come in and bring that idea, suggestion, you say no. Your mind got to be renewed, though. If your mind is not renewed, what do you say? Y'all scramble the fence, I see. All right. Okay, I want you to get number four. The only way, man, see, the Bible says they that have received Christ, they that have been crucified with Christ have crucified the flesh with the lust thereof. That's a scripture. So, you get the victory. The scripture says this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Although Jesus was born a spotless lamb, in other words, he had never experienced sin, but we become without sin and without fault when we are what? When we are saved and when we pass from darkness to light. Amen. Old things pass away. Behold, all things become what? New. How many believe that state or condition of being after you're saved, completely, you know, filled with the Holy Spirit, and you have been delivered from the power of darkness, the dominion of sin, the power of Satan has been broken over your life, and you are just free? All right, do you believe that state of being is equivalent to the state of being that Jesus experienced, amen, in his sinless state? Or do you believe that Jesus' condition, state of life, or his state of life was maybe on a higher plane than yours after you are saved and you are born of God? So when God comes in you and make you a new creation, do you believe that you are just as good as Jesus? Say what?
Absolutely.
All right, you believe you're good as Jesus. All right. Well, what'd you say, brother? What?
Well, I'm thinking of you to grow in grace.
Okay, you have to grow. Okay, Brother Wayne said, well, you're not quite as good as Jesus right away. You got to grow to a certain point before you be as good as Jesus. Now, so we got two things. Is that, I'm not putting words in your mouth, am I? Okay. Certain levels of what? Growth and perfection.
But that doesn't mean that the baby's not as good as an adult.
Right, right. Okay, that's good because Jesus went through all of those stages too, right? He wasn't as perfect in terms of his nature without being allowed how sin he was, but he had to grow as a what? As a child, right? He increased in what? Stature, wisdom, and in favor with what? God and with man. Is that right? That's good, right? So we need to see the definition that we often give for righteousness is the ability to stand before God without a sense of what? Inferiority, guilt, or what else? Or without feeling any sense of lack or need. In other words, it's just as if sin had never existed. That's the aspect of righteousness that we need to understand, that it's just as if sin never existed. Now, let me tell you, if a person's sins have been remitted, amen, how much sin does he exist in his life? Okay, and I tell you, you know, you might say, well, although we might just be delivered, we might, all our sins will be, you know, our cast into the sea of forgetfulness, as far as the east is from the west, God removes our sins, and he has no remembrance of them. But somebody might say that, yet you are still undeveloped, and the propensity to sin might be a lot stronger than the propensity that Jesus was, he was challenged with, right? All right, but I would be willing to say if a person gets saved and get filled with the Holy Spirit and do like Jesus did, went into the wilderness 40 days. You know, that's what Jesus did in order to get beyond the realm of temptation. Because that's what everybody are subject to after you get saved. You're subject to what? Temptations. And if your flesh is not what? Strong enough, there's a propensity for you to what? To give in and to what? And to lose fellowship, break fellowship. But Jesus went into the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights, and he fasted, and he was exposed to all of the temptations of Satan. And when he came out of the wilderness, he came out of the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's when his miracle ministry began. And I know that if a person today, I know some countries where they teach that a person for 6 months, they need to spend their life in fasting and in prayer until they get renewed in their minds and they ascend to the place in God where they are not prone to submit or to yield to sin. I believe that this has a lot of credence, I think. I think this is something very powerful, because I believe a miracle ministry for all of us could start if we at the initiation of our walk with the Lord, we would just spend quality time, you know, if we could afford it, just say a year, just seeking the Lord, fasting and praying, and just feeding on the Word and just getting established and getting our minds renewed. It wouldn't hardly be no sin in your life. You know, Brother Scales attests to the fact that, you know, he lives on a plane where he doesn't, you know, very few major things eat. He mentioned that he has actually succumbed to. I mean, he just, yeah, that, amen. But his life is given over to fasting, prayer, what else, winning souls, and things like that can keep sin completely neutralized, if not affect in your life. Amen. So I believe that we can live the same type of life Jesus lived, amen, today, if we would make the commitment and do the things that Jesus did. All right, let's move further. However, in his flesh as a man, the same Holy Spirit that anointed Jesus to do the works of God is the same Holy Spirit that anoints us to do the same works plus greater works than those that Jesus did. That should be something that we already understand. Jesus is our example today. Amen. Our example to follow. He came to live as a man in the flesh. And we know that Jesus was subject to temptations, all the temptations that we face today. Amen. He was exposed to the same temptations that the Bible says with all, amen. Despite the fact he was exposed to temptation, he never yielded. Amen. All right, he came to live as a man in the flesh to show us what was possible. As a man, he was holy, harmless, undefiled, and separate from sinners. A holy life is the secret of faith and power with God, and it is something that's attainable by every believer. All right, let's read that last sentence together. A holy life is the what? A faith and power with God, and it is something that's attainable. And that's one of the reasons why we are putting so much emphasis on holiness now, because holiness means that we'll solve a lot of problems. If we obey that aspect of the Word of God, boy, we wouldn't fall into near the temptations and have all of the challenges and all of the things that we are, you know, are succumbing to. I want you to turn to James 3. A holy life is the secret of faith and power with God, and it is something that's attainable by every believer. Something that every believer can attain unto. All right, James 3 is the same chapter that we got all of the tongue scriptures from the other day. The tongue tamed in scriptures. All right, let's look at James 3:17. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy, good fruits, without partiality, and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. So we can see that the tongue is the key to reaching the state of perfection, or the state where your mind is going to be renewed in Christ. And that wisdom is described in verse 17. Okay, wisdom is probably love perfected. Love in its perfect state. But it's first pure. Everybody said pure. All right, so that's the key. Love is first what? Holy. Then what? Peaceable. Then what? Gentle. And easy to be entreated. Full of mercy and good fruits. So full of mercy and good fruits is probably one of the most powerful components in enabling us to live a holy life, because you're going to be occupied mainly with going about as Jesus did, doing good and healing all of those that are oppressed of the devil. Whenever a person gets occupied completely with the things of God, then they are not prone to what? To bear fruit that are not of that's of evil work. They're not prone to do that. How many understand that if a person is full of mercy and good fruits, probably will come close to living a holy life than everybody is? Anybody can see that? Nobody can see that. Somebody's giving a good stab. Person is full of mercy and what? Good fruits. They're going to what? The fastest way even to grow in grace is what? By what? By doing this. Why is it people that reach out, always ministering to people, blessing folk, praying for folk, helping them to get established, helping them to walk in the fullness of God, why is it that they don't remain babes like everybody else? They just grow real fast, real fast. Anybody understand that? Amen. How many want to be full of the fruits of mercy? All right. Now, what do you have to do to be full of mercy and the fruits? You got to what? You got to show it. You got to release it. Love ain't love until what? You give it away. All right. All right. I guess this is getting boring, y'all. Let's move on. All right. Let's look over on the next page. A holy life is the secret of faith and power of God, and it is something that's obtainable by every people. Amen. People fear you, respect you when you live a holy life. They don't pay you no attention if you talk one thing and do another. If you talk about a mile and walk about an inch and don't live a nickel worth of dog meat, nobody what? Respect you. Pay you no attention. And they ain't gonna what? They ain't gonna submit to you. But when you live a life, amen, that life is gonna command with what? Respect. Amen. Living a life means you do everything. Our Bible said there's no offense between what you have. You live a life that's free of offense toward God and toward man. All right, let's look at the first thing on page 32. When you realize that he did not resist temptation nor perform supernatural works with some unfair advantage over you, but did it just like you have to do it, it will put fresh life into you, and Jesus becomes your hero all over again. Let me read that again. I want somebody to elaborate on that. When you realize that he did not resist temptation, nor perform supernatural works with some unfair advantage over you, but did it just like you have to do it, it will put fresh life into you, and Jesus becomes your hero all over again. I want somebody to put it in a different form. Just say it different, because you might understand it even better if somebody else break it down another way. All right? Is that too deep? All right. All right. Oh, y'all want me to call on you? Jesus did not resist temptation, nor perform supernatural works with some unfair advantage over you, but did it just like you have to do it, it will put fresh life into you, and Jesus becomes your hero all over again. All right. All right, brother. Wayne, you should be a little bit more prepared for this than anybody else. All right, so how would you put that in your own words, brother? Glenn Wayne. Can everybody say amen? Everybody say yes?
I just say, you rely on God, you know, the Bible, for everything that he could fulfill the ministry that he placed before him. He just depended on, basically just depended on him, instead of on his own self, and his, you know, attribute that he had when he was in heaven.
All right. Okay. How many hear? Did everybody hear? All right. We're gonna ask y'all to come down. Y'all sit too far back to hear, unless I'm talking on the mic. Okay, that sounds like a good answer. Cause somebody else, I'm gonna give the other person the mic.
One of the temptations that Jesus experienced was one that you mentioned earlier, and that was after he had fasted. He still was incarnate. He was still human when he experienced that. And he didn't have any advantage over me if I would go through that same kind of fast or whatever. I could resist. He didn't have anything at his disposal to resist other than the word of God. Mm-hmm. He told Satan, it is written. It is written. He referred to the word. So he didn't have, and that's what I can do, refer to the word when a temptation comes to me as well. So knowing that, I can draw that parallel, the same that, you know, with Jesus, is, you know, I can draw it as like, okay, there was no advantage there that he has over me when I looked at that particular situation. It was not, he wasn't operating as God when Satan tempted him. He was operating as a man.
Okay. All right. That's good. She focused on the aspect of the word that enabled Jesus to resist. Okay. Are there other things that Jesus relied on too, other than just the word? Okay. Okay, I'm going to let Brother Rod Dennis.
He also relied on fasting and praying. And, you know, when I read this, it just reminds me that so oftentimes when I start to remember exactly what his sacrifice was that he did, that he gave for us, and just remember that he did, when he went through that temptation, to go through it for that long period of time, it just reminds me that, yeah, he was just like a man. He was just like me. And as difficult as it is even now for us to go through that temptation, when you really start to understand what he did and how he went through it and how he showed that example, and to me that's what it really means. It just reminds me every single time that he showed me the example of how I can go through it, regardless of what comes at me, how often it comes at me, and it comes very strong, that I can still stand and still do the exact same thing. He was tempted. I'm going to be tempted. He went through it for a long, long, long period. You know, there are many times when I feel like I've been through it for a long, long period as well. And I'm still standing, still here, and still able to go through it. So when you start to understand exactly what he did, and you sort of relate that to what you're going through, that should give you the idea that, yeah, I'm just as strong, I'm just as good, I can still do it just as well. And so let it keep coming. If it keeps coming, I'll just keep doing what I'm doing.
Okay, so he relied on the word. He relied on what? Fasting?
Prayer.
I mean, the strength that he got from what? Fasting and prayer. And Jesus spent countless times going into seclusion, right? Up the mountain.
He also relied on, he was in close communion with the Father, his Father. And that encompasses the word, fasting, and prayer. But it says he did those things that were pleasing to his Father. Mm-hmm. And in order for him to be pleasing to his Father, he had to be in contact with him, you know, what the Father wanted. Mm-hmm. So he was in close communion with the Father.
All right, close communion means that what? You are intimately involved in prayer, the word, and all of the things that you need to draw strength from. All right, how does that make you, how does that put new life in you as a believer when you know that? Brother Al? You're pretty up on this now. Does that give you encouragement when you look at that, how Jesus did it?
Well, it gives me encouragement because I know that if Jesus could do it, he said that we can do all things.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I know that if he could do it, then I can do it also.
Mm-hmm.
And it all begins with work. We have to work it and just do it.
Right. All right, so when you began to think about how Jesus overcame all of his challenges and how the disciplines, right, and all of the weapons he used, that if I use the same weapons, I'll get the same what? Results. Right? All right, Brother Holman, just give us your evaluation of what we're talking about now. Say something. I know we also said yes, I don't like them if I just put a mic in my
It kind of encourages me in a way that it showed how he emptied himself, not relying upon himself, but always trusting in God to lead him in his endeavors and to do the works. Because he said that we're not able to do anything for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to rely on, you know, God's Spirit, which the covenant that we have now versus what he was using, what he's operating in, is better.
Woo, come on, say that again.
That covenant is better because now we've got the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm. Woo, glory.
And of course, he was, like Sister Hill said, he was totally in favor of what God had sent him to do. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was on board with everything that God wanted to be done through his life.
Right.
So, but for us, now that we know God's will as well, we're strengthened by the better covenant, which is him sending his Spirit and him being in Christ, being the head of us,
mm-hmm.
because he's conquered everything by him being the head.
Right.
So if he's a part of our life and the head of our life, then we're conquerors as well.
Wow. Okay, so he's already conquered, gotten the victory. He says that whosoever was born of God have what? Already overcome.
Yeah.
This is the victory that what?
Overcome
even our what? Amen. So we already got the victory.
Yeah.
Amen. We can go in our temptation knowing that we already what? Have the victory. Greater is he that is what? Alright? I can do all things through who?
Christ.
The Apostle Paul says, no more I, but it's the who? Christ that what? Lives in me. Amen. That's the thing that gives you what? Motivation and encouragement and make Jesus your hero what? All over, because he's fought the battle and he has what? Won the victory. And greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. All right, Sister Mary Ann, you said something that we said tonight, just elaborate on something.
I don't like to just put mics in front of people and not pre-warning them. Anybody else? All right. Sister Shirley, you get anything out of that?
Yes.
You can do all things now through Christ?
Yes, I sure can.
All right, greater is he that is in who?
Me.
All right.
Can I have another analogy?
All right, come on, Brother Rob.
Another analogy that I think can be very important, because Jesus was in the will of his Father,
mm-hmm.
let me just use the analogy of our Father, you know, my Father.
Mm-hmm.
Growing up and even at this very moment, if I'm in his will, if I know what his rules and regs are, if I know what he wants me to do, and I'm doing those things consistently, I'm bound to probably have a really good time. But when I didn't do those things that he wanted me to do while growing up, it was going to be rough.
Mm-hmm.
So when I use that same analogy here, he knew exactly what he needed to do. He knew exactly what the will of his Father was. So he followed that,
right.
And he prospered for that. And he's showing us that we can do the same thing by knowing the will of our spiritual Father as well, too.
That's good. All right. That's good. Anybody else got a revelation? All right.
Anybody else? All right. Let's look at number 7. The fact that Jesus did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, shows us that we don't have to sin. If you couldn't help from sinning, you would never have to repent because you wouldn't be responsible. Does that make sense? No, y'all think through it. The fact that Jesus did no sin, like it was guile found in his mouth, shows us that we don't have to sin. The Bible said don't let sin reign in your mortal body. Right? Alright? So we have the ability. The Bible says whosoever is born of God does not what? Commit sin. That means habitually commit sin. For the seed remains in him and he cannot sin because he's born of God. So when we're born of God and receive the Holy Spirit and walk in the Spirit, we are programmed to live a life without sin. Everything needed in order for us to live a life free from sin is already, amen, working within us. All we have to do is want to, or make the decision, or make the choice. The Bible says, put ye on the Lord Jesus and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. So that's the decision you have to make, because you got everything you need. You have the Holy Spirit, you have the Word of God. And let me tell you, when you first get saved, surrounded by saints, coming to church, and being faithful, that's enough word to what? To sustain you. Because saints got their lungs around you, they're praying, right? They're encouraging you. Amen. You have enough grace until you're able to walk on your own feet. So there's no reason why you have to continue in sin after you're born again and you have all of that support, filled with the Holy Ghost, amen, walking in the Spirit, you know, in prayer, amen. You have enough grace working and operating to enable you to live a life free and separated from sin. How many remember in the old church, some of y'all were a part of the old church, we had to get up. They encouraged us to testify in every service. Sister Cornelius, Sharon, and Sister Sylvia.
Sister Sylvia and Sister Herb.
Okay. All right. Tell us how you used to work in the old church. Testimony. Y'all remember how you used to work in the old church? Okay, I want y'all to hear this, because I think that this is one of the reasons why y'all are so quiet. I was at my brother's church the other night, and it was about the same number of people there, and everybody talked. I watched them. Every single person had comments, and some of them were pretty long. And they talked loud. They were bold. But they were trained to what? To testify. And that's where, I guess we fall short in charismatic circles, because nobody hardly make a practice of what? Testifying in services. All right, tell us how we used to do in testimony service.
But you
stood
up?
No, just use the mic.
You want me to tell you the mic that you stood up?
Right. Alright, and any other thing God had done for them, they will what? And any scripture that would be a confession of who they are in Christ, they would what? They would declare it. And as a result of that, they grow to be bold. A lot of them sing their own song. Man, so I don't know if there's any way that we can probably learn from that, but I think it will be good for us to be a little bit more straightforward in declaring the goodness of the Lord. And when we hold it in, then we just what? We just lose our joy. And I think that every opportunity that you have to say something in here, join the discussion. Man, I'm talking to the choir now, I guess. All right. And, okay, I want somebody to tell me the reason why many times we don't hear more confessions, even in prayer, like Brother Troy was on Monday night, are people that are constantly, even in prayer, you don't hear a lot of people affirming who they are in Christ. We need to get at the bottom of this problem, because this is a great hindrance. If we don't make a practice of consistently affirming who we are in Christ, you know, Jesus made a practice of what? Consistently affirming who he was. I mean, if you go through the book of St. John, you'll see, I don't know how many times Jesus was telling whoever he was addressing, whoever he was talking to, he was always declaring who he was. Amen. So, why is it that many times we're so slow to declare who we are in Christ? And you don't have to have a forum. You don't have to speak, you know, all the time in Bible study or on Sunday mornings. Sometimes there are times that we give you space to have a testimony, and many times you have to kind of check with somebody to make sure that somebody will respond, because if you just leave it open, sometimes nobody will come up. Seems like, you know, we don't have that boldness. But if you talk with, if I call Sister Mary Ann, Sister Mary Ann, I want you to have a testimony Sunday, you know, usually there's no problem with that. But just getting up and just, you know, declaring the word and making a confession or expressing who you are in Christ is something that many times we're not good at. Now, the best time to do that probably is in prayer. Anybody understand what I'm saying? In prayer. Okay, for instance, like the scriptures, the Lord God is a sun and shield. He gives grace and glory. Whosoever is born of God overcometh the world. This is the victory that overcomes the world, even my faith. There are numerous of scriptures that we could very easily confess in prayer that will build us up, and our prayer will go to 10 different levels greater. I just want to know, is it that we don't believe it would have any impact on our spiritual life, or maybe we just don't, or, you know, take time to do it, or we're not motivated? Maybe I'm not motivating you to do it enough. Okay, why is it that you never hardly hear confessions that expresses who you are or what God is to you, and that new creation reality, the Lord God is a sun and shield? Name some more. Greater is he that is in you than he in me than he that is in the world. Name some more. All right, some more. Yes, the Lord is the light. He's the light of my salvation. The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? I fear not. Be not dismayed. I am your God, and I will, you know, strengthen you. I will uphold you. No weapon formed against me will prosper. Name some more of them. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Greater is he that is in me. I'm complete in him.
Now you ask what is in him. Same. Usually when you ask for a testimony, mm-hmm. people, it takes a different format than what you're seeing.
Right. Usually. So it takes a different format. Testimonies take a different format. Right. Yeah. I agree.
People's thoughts to crystallize. Okay. You know, people just don't want to get up and just say something. You have to think about what you're going to say and how it's going to connect if it has meaning.
That's good.
But I want you to answer this part. On Monday night, in prayer, how would you explain that away?
That's different.
All right, come on.
You're talking about something different from Monday night.
Okay, well, just hit it. Just give us some thought on that. All right. So the prayer is, no.
The prayer is, don't give it up, Mike. Okay, anyway, Sister Shirley, why is it that many times on Monday night we don't hear people excited about, the Lord is the strength of my life? I mean,
while
the prayer, well, why don't we hear more? I guess we hear a little bit of it. Brother Travis, come on down.
I think sometimes people are just tired.
Okay. That's probably the answer. We just what?
Yeah.
Tired.
Yeah, we just don't feel like we worked a long
we worked a long day.
And it's just like, if I can just get there and sit on the pew, at least I'll be there.
All right.
Well, you know.
Okay, well, that might be the reason.
I mean, that may be a reason for it, you know, maybe.
But if we would begin to declare things like that, do you think that could turn circumstances around?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sometimes as Christians, though, we're so prone to be conditioned to hear.
Come on, brother.
We're mostly prone to sit in the pews and to hear messages, which that has conditioned us.
Right.
To where versus speaking the word of God, where it becomes life and where it's being spoken from the abundance of our heart.
Right.
But I think it's because we as Christians, we just become prone to hearing so much.
Right.
And not speaking.
And being prayed too?
Yes. Yes.
Oh boy, we better change some aggressive over there. What do we do, brother? But I don't know. I thought we were trying to get it over.
All right.
Also, I think also a little bit about more or less, especially on prayer night. Because it seems like you're more focused in intercessory, and maybe at least for myself, I may not be on the way to church, maybe, you know, praying or whatever. Then you know, more or less focused in praying for a particular problem or situation, or the church itself, or individuals. So it don't be so more gratitude, other than what we know.
Right.
Yeah,
we have a tendency to read them, but I'm thinking about including these things in your prayer. Now, I know we can intercede and pray for, you know, the different things we need to pray for, but the things that make those things really exciting is that when we begin to express what's in our heart, what Christ is to us, when we begin to declare, that's the thing that takes the prayer to a different level. And so, we just wanted to bring that to your attention because I feel that our prayers need to be patterned after the prayers and the examples of Jesus. You know, always confessing who you are in Christ. Now, I wonder, is there any way that we could find these things that we need to be saying to God and saying to ourselves and things that will be... Anybody know where we could find some scriptures, all these scriptures in one place where we could just go to them and just start meditating them so that in prayer secretly for the first 15 or 20, 30 minutes, we could just begin to build ourselves up and begin to what? Say these things to ourselves and say them to God?
We have a meditation book and a prayer book. That's your meditation book. Already
y'all know if any?
What
is the meditation book about? All right. Is it a gray book?
It's a prayer.
Okay. We're talking about the confession book, or we're talking about the big meditation book?
Oh. Oh.
Okay.
The author is James Hill.
Oh. All right. Well, the reason why I'm going over this is because I hate to see y'all miss out on so much. This is the thing that has meant so much to me in my efforts and ministries and the things that God has given me. I've put together, materials that's being used all over the nation. And
many of the churches that have received this material have grown a whole lot more than we have here. And many of them just feast on this, just like, I mean, they live by it. A lot of them do. Okay, Sister Hill said, profit without what? Right. Okay, now this is the book here. Remember, I spent several weeks going over those scriptures. The Lord's Compassion Manual. And I'm going to let everybody have it for what I put into it. $200. The type in, and they charge you about 10 cents a page when you go to the printer. And how much y'all think this is about? A whole lot of things, but it's all real neat and nice. And this is what you need. Very simple. Some maybe already have it because I left them back there. See, I got about half of what I left back there. I'm not accusing the saints. All right, so I'll let y'all have it. And on credit, if you give me $10, I'll get the money. Now, this is not to be taken off Founders Day. But this book here will revolutionize your life. But I know that most of y'all probably would take this serious because it's just me telling you this, but I spent a whole lot of time putting this together. And this information in this book here, it has all of these life-enriching scriptures already in place, and it will be a real blessing to you. Sister Perry, what do you think about this little book? Okay, it's packed full of things that you need to build yourself up. So whenever you can come up with $10, or if you want to get it on credit, but you got to pay. All right, so this is what you need. Because we miss out on a whole lot of things that we could do very easily. And this prayer meeting on Monday night could be smoking. It could be smoking. I mean, it could be so anointed. And by the way,
it's anointed now. You want to say more.
Yeah, a lot more anointed. I mean, people can be praying out like we should be praying out. Okay, next week we're going to, this is a good time because next week we're going to ask you to come for prayer. Monday night, we're going to be here probably most mornings. Tomorrow morning at 5, we will be having prayer. Friday morning at 5, we will be having prayer. And this book will be very instrumental in helping you, amen, to get into a flow. I want to see saints, amen, making confessions and really receiving the benefits of confessing and speaking these words, amen, that will build them up to God. So at the close of the service, if you want to, amen, we've probably got 15 to 20 here tonight. All right, let's all stand. Praise the Lord. And that's all we're going to do in terms of chapter 5. We've gone over this enough. Next week, we're going to probably devote, we're going to go from chapter 4 to chapter 5. And next week, we're going to be in a consecration. We're going to be fasting. And more than likely, we might spend our time are doing something that relates to consecration on next Wednesday. Next Monday night, next Wednesday night, we're going to devote a lot of time to praying and to building you up in terms of consecration. And we will be praying in the mornings of next week, Monday through Wednesday, Monday through Thursday. However the Lord leads. All right, and everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Father, we thank you tonight as we leave this place. We leave knowing that you who begun the good work will continue to perform it. Father, our eyes are upon you. You're the author, you're the finisher of our faith. Lord, your grace is sufficient for me. Lord, that's all I want to just say. Your grace is sufficient for me. Hallelujah. And I am what I am. Lord, this is just a confession. And as I say this, Lord, it gives me greater boldness. It gives me more confidence. It makes me feel better about myself. I am what I am because of the grace of God. Oh, Father, you are in me, the hope of glory. I can do all things through you that strengthens me. Hallelujah. Lord, I'm an overcomer. Thank you for making me an overcomer. Whosoever is born of God, overcometh, for this is the victory that overcometh the world, even my faith. Lord, when I say that with my mouth and believe it in my heart and release those words, oh God, something takes place, something kicks in on the inside of me. It gives me greater zeal and fervor, raises me up, motivates me, it inspires me. It gives me divine energy. Father, you're greater than all. It's you that worketh in me the will and the do of your good pleasure. Lord, it's you that doeth the work. Just put your hands up. Lord, it's you that doeth the works. It's you that doeth the works. I can do all things through you that strengthens me. Amen. Just say that. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Oh, he's in me, ha, 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 ha. And greater is he that is in me than is in the world. Father, I thank you tonight. Glory, hallelujah. Because it's you that worketh in me the will and the ability to do whatever you have called me to do. And I give you praise and the glory tonight in Jesus' name. The name above every name. Hey, 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 hey. Lord, we love you tonight in great peace and they that love your law, and nothing shall offend them. We give you praise and the glory in Jesus' name. And now unto him that is able to keep me from falling and able to present me faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy to the older wise God, our Savior, be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Everybody said together, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Everybody just repeat with me. I can do all things.
I can do all things.
Through Christ. That strengthens me. He is the strength of my life.